Hello everyone and welcome to my video on this, the Zeiss Icon Box Tangor 56/2, which is, I believe, the last iteration of the Box Tangor cameras. A very slick, and by box camera standards, very complex camera. This is a 6x9 format box camera. It has no light meter, a very simple light leaf shutter with an instant shutter speed of approximately 1/30th of a second. You can also do time photos with this, which is your flash sync speed. You can only use a flash with this camera if you manually trigger it while the shutter is propped open. And yes, according to my notes, this is in fact the last of the Box Tangor cameras made by Zeiss, and it ended a 35-year production run for the Box Tangor lineup, which featured 6x9 format cameras from the onset. This is a 6x9 format, when Goers made the first one in 1924. So there were other formats, 645, 127, and a couple of others I'm blanking on, but this was the last of the 6x9 format models. Zeiss made this to target the enthusiast and travel photographer looking for a simple camera, but also one that was made by Zeiss. And basically this could take large photos, it could be quite easily turned into postcards to send home, and because of the negative size of 6 cm by 9 cm, it could still have suitable resolution even with a simple lens design up at the front of the camera. So this does include adjustable focus and different apertures to give you some level of focus and aperture control, and we'll go through that throughout the course of this video to show you how that works. It was, and by the way, for a box camera, this is exceedingly feature-packed. This was made by Zeiss in Dresden, Germany, with a lens built in Berlin from 1951 until 1956. Now, if you have your Zeiss Icon 56/2, we're going to go over all of the features on it and talk about what everything is. We're going to start here on the top. This, of course, is where the strap would have gone if it was still attached to the camera. This is your portrait orientation viewfinder window. This right here, you might have just seen it turned red as I advanced, is your ready to fire indicator. And when you fire the shutter, now this goes to black, indicating that you cannot take another photo. On the front of the camera, we have your viewfinder windows here, portrait orientation, landscape orientation. This is your focus distance selector. So we have 3 to 6 meters, 6 to 20 meters, 20 meters to infinity. Weirdly, that seems like that should actually be feet. I wonder if this was a US export model and that's actually in feet, not meters, which would make a whole lot more sense for those distance scales. At any rate, whether this is meters or feet, it's gonna tell you the distance that you're focused at, okay? Here's your lens, which is a Goers Frontar Achromat lens, an F9. This is your aperture selection of F9, F11, or F16, right like that. This side of the camera has your film advance knob right here, which also unlocks the shutter after you take a photo. This is your film back release lever right here. Here's your portrait, landscape orientation, viewfinder. This is your shutter button, cable release port right there. And this is your shutter lock button. So basically you have two shutter locks here. You can lock your shutter. So you have two shutter locks. Your shutter will not fire until you have advanced the film after taking a photo. And you can also lock it so that you don't accidentally take a photo while you're holding this and ruin a frame, because there are only 8 shots on 6x9. So when that's red and this is red, you're ready to take a photo. This side of the camera has a couple of different things. This is, insofar as I can tell, an aftermarket sports finder. You look through the back here, and this is a quick way to just hold the camera up to your eye and take photos. I mean, it's, I guess, kind of neat. It's kind of weird too, because like, I don't know, maybe if you want to hold this up to your face rather than at your waist level, that's what it's for. This is also a flash PC socket. And what this allows you to do is connect the flash to your camera with a PC cable, just like a modern PC cable right there. That's how much camera standards change over time. And you can trigger a flash in your instant mode. And insofar as I know that, yes, your xenon bulbs will work with this. The camera's bottom doesn't have a whole lot to see, but you can see here a 1/4-20 tripod socket. There is no side-mounted tripod socket, which is a bit curious. And then on the back here, you can see your Zeiss icon, Germany, and then this window slide covers the red window, which means that you don't risk your fog, your film being fogged by stray light passing through the red window when you use it. And this is a 120 format film camera, by the way, so you can get this camera, go into any camera shop that sells 120 format, 120 rolls of film, and you can go and use this camera today with modern film. To get inside of the camera, we're going to lift up on this post right here. You can see it's lifted right there. We're going to slide the back of the camera off just like that. Here on the top of the camera is the take-up spool for the film. So when you advance the film after a photo, it's taken up on here. This is a roller to help the film move through the camera smoothly. Here's another roller to help the camera move the film move through the camera smoothly. This is where your new film will go, and we'll see that in just a minute. And then lastly, here is your image area. This is the size of your negative. It's a gigantic negative, so pretty darn neat. While we have the camera back open, I'm going to show you how the focus works on this camera, okay? So let's see if we got a light down there. Yes, we do. So the first thing I want to show you is how the focus on this camera works. Right now we're set at 20 meters to infinity. If I set this to 20 feet or whatever it is to infinity, if I set it through 6 to 20, this doesn't actually move the lens in and out. What it does is slide another element behind the lens to adjust focus. If I go to the closest focus point of 3 to 6, it puts in a different lens. So the focus on this is by it putting in an auxiliary lens, not by moving the lens, which means you don't have smooth focus. If you set your focus halfway in between, say 6 and 20 and 20 and infinity, you're actually just going to end up with a very jacked up photo, okay? So you do have to use an actual focus point. For the aperture control, right now I'm at f9. If we switch this to f11, which is a bit fiddly to do when I can't even see the thing, f9, f11 inserts a waterhouse stop, f22 inserts a smaller waterhouse stop. So you can't do an intermediate f-stop with this camera, because if you do, you're once again just going to end up with a jacked up photo where the image is blocked by your aperture. So it uses waterhouse stops, not an iris. While we have the camera open, I'm going to show you how to load film in it. So here's the empty area of the camera where we're going to put the new film. We simply angle the film in with the spring side, drop it into place, and just kind of shift it around until the tab on this side catches the other end of the 120 spool. We're going to pull out a leader, feed it through the camera this way, until we get to the take-up spool on the top of the camera. Feed the paper back leader into the take-up spool, and now we're going to advance the knob to start taking up the film. And we're going to do that until we go back to the bottom and we get the arrows to this corner right here. Now at this point, we want to put the cameras back onto the camera like this and lock it into place. Now that we have the film loaded, we're going to come here to the red window and lift up the window slide. And we're going to advance the film until we see some arrows pass, and then we'll see some indicators pass, and eventually we will get to a number. That means we're getting close, and there's the number 1. You might be able to see the number 1 there. Now we close the window and we are on the first frame, and we're ready to go take a photo with the camera, just like that. Now, once we have taken our photo, we open up the red window here and we advance to the second frame. Look for the film type indicator. That means we're getting close. And there we are, frame number 2. Close the window and you're ready to go and take your next photo. But if you don't want to take it right away, just lock the shutter so that you don't accidentally ruin a frame of your film. And then when you are ready, take your photo just like that. Okay. Film is one and done. It's important to remember that. It can record light a single time using a proper shutter speed and aperture with a lens to focus light to form an image, or it can record photons in an uncontrolled manner by receiving every one of them that it can if you did something like I just did. But I want you to see what happens inside of this camera as film moves through it. If you remember, we saw the 2 in the red window. That's this 2 right here. After you take a photo and advance the film, you're physically moving the film through the camera until you get to the number 3, which would now appear in the red window if the back of the camera were still on. And you just do this over and over and over again until you get to frame 8. After frame 8, you advance the whole way until the film is, the paper is completely taken up on this top spool up here, and then you can remove the film. Let's pretend that the entire film has been advanced and it is on this spool. So once you finish your roll of film, the entire roll will be taken up on this top spool up here. And now it's time to remove it, which we do by pressing on the film spool like that and angling it out of the camera. Now there will be like a paper tape seal or something, glue seal on that. You fold this over, you seal it up, and you stick it in your camera bag or your pocket to send it off to the lab or develop it yourself. And then you take this spool down here, angle it out with the spring right here, pull it out and put it into this side of the camera, spring into take up spool. There we go. Turn the spool knob until it's taken up, and now it's been swapped out to here. Grab your next roll of film and load it in here to start using it, or if you're done for the day, simply close up your camera and set it off to the side. So, having seen basically everything that this camera can do, now we're going to talk about how to actually take a photo with it. The first thing you want to do is decide on your settings, your focus point, and your aperture, and just dial those in so that they're set correctly for what you want to do with your focus point and your exposure control. Okay, really simple to do. Next thing, you want to make sure you've got a red window on the top here and that you're ready to take a photo. You want to make sure that's red and that your shutter is unlocked. Now you're going to decide portrait orientation or landscape orientation. You're going to look through that window until, actually I want to do landscape. Let's do that, yeah. Until you have your photo lined up, and then you take your picture just like that. You just push the shutter button down. And when you push the shutter button down toward the bottom of the camera, it takes a photo, okay? And you also, by the way, if you want to shoot in time, right like that, I forgot to point this out earlier. This is your time versus instant switch right here. Instant time. What is time shooting? Time shooting is when you push, when you hold the shutter button down, this shutter will open as long as you hold it. And then when you release it, the shutter will close. You can also, with this camera, hold this down, slide the lock into place, and now the shutter will stay open without you having to hold the shutter down. That's kind of a neat trick. To end that, this type of time exposure, just unlock it and the exposure will end. So that's all the process of that. So that's how you take a photo. Framing, dial in your settings, take and activate the shutter. What about double exposures though? Well, this camera can't actually do that because the shutter mechanism and the film advance are linked and there's no way to override that. So this camera will not let you take a double exposure. You can only do single exposure photos with it. I do now have some tips for you about how to get the most out of your camera. First one is, if you are looking for a Box Tangor, honestly, this is the one to go with. It has the most capabilities. It's, even though it lacks the double exposure function that every other Box Tangor has, that's the only thing it's missing, and that's really not a big deal. It's also typically going to be in the best condition of the Box Tangors out there because it is the most robust build, and it was the last produced. And also, one other thing to bear in mind is mind your focus point and make sure that this is set correctly when you take photos. Otherwise, your photos are all going to come back blurry, and that's kind of annoying. So some things not to do with your camera. Don't let it get wet because the metal in this will rust and ruin your camera, and you don't want to let that happen. Also, don't keep it in your car. It's not necessarily going to be heat and cold affected, but it would be a tempting theft target. A lot of people who don't know cameras might look at that and say, that thing looks old and expensive. No, no, it's just old. And other than that, have fun with it and take care of it. Yes, it's a simple camera. Yes, it's fun to use, but it is still a Zeiss and it is still a precision tool that should be handled with care and respect, because as long as you take care of your camera will take care of you. Thank you everybody for watching, and I'll see you in whatever the next camera manual video is.